and everyone else.
So here we go. Picks and bans underway. Ahri being banned out by Giants. And Kennen, of course, removed by Alternate. Say, nope, Jim Bones. We heard D-Man say you're good on this champion, so therefore we're going to remove it.
I'm pretty sure that's the only reason, because they didn't have 28
days. Yeah, they had no idea.
Kanan was used to destroy evil geniuses in week 9.
And the fact that he was played against them in Warsaw as well, I'm sure that didn't give them any inkling.
No hints whatsoever.
Orianna and Cassidy, so that's another focus ban on Exterminari this time. All the focus on Pharrellan Lord so far.
Twisted Fates, Jarvan.
See, the players we focus on that we seem to know this game.
Who would have guessed?
I know.
Talking about champions
after
and
all
things
these,
like that.
All these months, we finally started to get it.
Yeah, making some sense. But I like the fact that Orianna was banned out. It's something that we've seen Giants. It means that they've done research on Pharrellan Lord, because his Orianna in game one against Wizards was not particularly good. I'm going to go right there. He was, of course, countered
by
Diana pretty heavily.
I've not seen in a long, long time.
Yep.
But Lee Sin.
Forcing Aranea out of his comfort zone. He was instrumental in the wins against Wizards earlier, and we'll see how that works out.
And well, of course, you can't let an LCS team have Twisted Fate. They will select them straight away. They know how strong it is. They've seen Peke in action, and Extermin's not bad on it himself.
So the question is now whether or not Kerp is going to run Shen up in this top lane or not. If he's going to decide to go on it, Zed is available, and we've seen Alternate insta-locking Zed a number of times. We may even see them go for something like an Ezreal Sona.
RNA does not look happy. He does not look happy. He's like, they banned my Lee Sin. Damn them.
Wonder if he'll play Alistar.
So
we'll see.
Too soon.
So if Shen does get locked in, maybe something like Shen Ezreal might be a possibility. Shen Zed could be something, and maybe putting Shen in the
You know, Kerp doesn't look too vocal about the fact that he's getting given a champion here. No, he is actually speaking now. He was just sort of sat back going, what are you giving me here? What are you giving me, Shen?
It has been locked in. Shen Ezreal.
Kraton has been taking Ezreal pretty much every single time, so no surprise there. It does mean that Varus is available if Jim Bones wants to take it, which is a champion he ran quite a few times towards the end of the season.
So he's definitely been practicing it. We actually talked to the Giants members leading up to week 10 and in terms of how they were prepping, and they were saying they were going back to their roots, trying to practice some new champions and just practice the basics. To be very honest, unfortunately, it did not work out for them. It didn't really, you know, translate into wins. I'd like to see who Morn's going to run in the jungle. We've seen him running Elise. Elise is free and open and has been a priority pick or ban, at least through some of the matches today. Maybe Varus Elise, Varus Nautilus, maybe even Hecarim. Those are my three guesses. Or wrong on all of them.
Well, of course, Zyra is the champion that the betters ran multiple times, and feeling they're going to go for that support. They do have the AD. AP champion already locked in, so that support lane, it's Babetta. It's actually what got them through in Warsaw as well. It was one of the champions they ran, I think, 100% of the time.
So Zyra is the champion that actually pretty much guaranteed the victories against Gambit. It was the Stranglethorns that just knocked everybody up in the air.
That was fast.
And the combination of the Stranglethorns as well as the Chain of Corruption is really, really good for their team. That was an insta-lock Diana from Pharrellan Lord.
That was very, very fast, yeah. And of course, he was very strong on Diana in game
three. Game three game of the three. Series. It was game one where Dragon was...
Day.
It was game one where Dragon did really, really well with it and really, you know, worked hard. The Ezreal Sona combination, again, we're going to see from Ulton, and they're going to go for this kiting composition, which is going to have much less of an impact against a Twisted Fate, a Nasus, a Rumble, where they don't need to be running at you to continually be dealing damage. If a good Equalizer and Grasping Roots or Stranglethorns goes down, you're just going to get melted by that Equalizer.
So Nasus and Rumble will be selected. No, switching it to Nautilus at the last second, which does leave the jungler available. Will it be Nasus? Will he be taking that away? Of course, could go for Jarvan.
Could go for Jarvan, is free and is open, and I think Jarvan might actually work in terms of locking people in. But again, you know, if you get the Chain of Corruption down, if you get the wild cards out, the Equalizer, that's a lot of range to deal with. And you can actually deal that damage through a Cataclysm. So Nautilus is a good interrupt, is a good way of dealing with that. We may even see a top laner. If it is, it's going to be Jungle Shen.
Which means it is going to be Jungle Shen, which is probably what Kurt was saying.
Yeah.
You know, I don't fancy Shen, honestly. Yeah. You can have it.
So, you know, Kerp has played aggressive top laners. He's played Shen and Zed in two of his games, and we'll see how he's going to match up now against Rumble, because this is going to be a matchup that's going to be determined in these early levels. Both of them have the ability to poke from range and deal very good damage, and whoever gets that leg up, that initial advantage, will be able to just take control of the lane.
So those are the teams selected. This is, of course, the first best of five. What are we seeing overall as the game was to progress, and maybe even level one, maybe, because this is an LCS team, maybe they're going to go for a level one fight.
Possibly. At the moment, Araneia's jungle Z. So maybe Araneia's been, you know, taking a page out of Insect's
book. Champion.
And gonna be, it's probably gonna be a better matchup. It probably suits Araneia's playstyle, actually, if you think about it. He is a pretty aggressive jungler. He does like to get in people's faces. And it will fulfill that gank, kill people type of role that he was doing with Lee Sin.
It's serious game time. It is the first best of five. This is for a place in the LCS of the Summer Split. It is going to be Giants on the blue team and Alternate Avs the red team. The Twisted Fate has managed to sneak himself through, as has Sen and Diana and Varus and many, many other champions. But will we see a level one engage for the first time in around about 20 matches?
At the moment, there is just this little standoff. Both teams looking at one another. Varus goes out, doesn't catch anybody. The ward was killed, so everybody being close enough to land the auto attacks and finishing off. Now remember that even though Twisted Fate was insta-locked as the first pick, Alternate would have discussed this on some level because Diana is a very good counter. Diana can kill Twisted Fate quickly, can wave clear quickly, and can, you know, pin Twisted Fate in that mid lane.
You may even say that she is a little dirty.
Just a little bit in terms of the wave clearing abilities. We'll see whether or not Ferenilord can channel this inner ability and maybe take out Exta. It would be, at the moment, not an upset because the public vote thinks that Ultimate will win this series.
We'll see if that is how that works out. Will we see any LCS teams going down to the amateur hopefuls, or will they all manage to hold their place in the Summer Split? You'll find out over the next few hours, because this is going to be a long, drawn-out occasion. A pink ward does get put down by Giants. They're making sure they keep that vision over on the Wraith Bush.
This is almost the most action we've seen at level one. The pink ward war has begun. What we do see, though, from both of these teams is the indication that we're not going to have lane swaps. It does look like we're going to have a straight up top v top, mid v mid, and duo v duo in that bottom lane.
So Exterminator's going to help out. Morden and Samux taking out Wolves. RNA is also going to get a little bit of help from Kreatz on that.
He's gone very low just to the Wolves.
Just on the Wolves, yeah.
If we're going to be honest. But we'll see how much assistance he gets over at the blue buff. I assume they'll stick around, give him a smiteless pull, and allow him to move around over to red.
Yeah, you got to assume that's because nobody really helped him leash it. We do see Morden taking down that blue buff already. There's going to be the blue buff for RNA. Yeah. Yes, it is. Yeah. I can see the buff on him. It was a long time, though, Kreatz spent there, which means he's lost a bit of CS in towards that bottom lane. It does mean that they're probably going to hit level 2 first.
So one of the things that does work into their favor a little bit about that is it does mean the wave will be pushing up against him for the next couple of minutes. So we'll see how well that works out.
But the Giants didn't take the Golems, so they're not maybe going to rush through towards it. Ferenilord being very aggressive on Extermin there already in this mid lane. We'll see how this fight battles out. The mana card being used by Exterminator to keep himself topped off. This bottom lane is going to be an interesting focus. We do see level 2 for Kreatz. He stayed around a little bit longer on the Wolves and the Golems, so maybe that's where these levels are coming from. Ferenilord getting focused again there. Jim Bones, though, he's backing towards position. And look at this, he's already starting to win the CS farm.
So this is something we need to keep a good eye on in terms of the mana on Jayree. How much he has to keep Kreatz up on health. And then, of course, Kreatz is going to be taking some poke whenever he goes into last hit. Varus does outrange him with his auto attacks. And obviously, with the percentage damage he can get down from those Blighted Quiver stacks, it will be working into his favor. At the moment, there is a decent wave that should balance out those numbers a little bit.
We'll see. Keep her eye on that one. Meanwhile, in the top lane, that's actually very even between them. You can see Araneia is looking to maybe get up there, and he has managed to successfully dodge the wards that were put down. With that ward in the Tri-Bush spot him out? No, he won't. So he snuck into the... Samux just put the ward down in the bush, and Araneia will get spotted.
You'd think there's an Elise in the game because his spider senses were right on point there. Manages to get it down. Kreatz's been caught.
Kreatz's getting a lot of focus on him there. You can see Bubetta just throwing those lashes in towards him, Jim Bones. Throwing the hail of arrows on top of him. He's pretty low right now. Bubetta took a couple of hits in the process. Jim Bones almost getting focused by the turret, but backed out at just the right moment.
Now, this is the lane that's going to be the most important for the Giants, because if Jim Bones gets off to a good start, his team does tend to do fairly well in that mid-game. And look at the poke that they're putting down into Kreatz. Bubetta's running a little bit low on mana, and he's got no more biscuits or mana pots to, you know, stock himself back up. So once he runs low again, that's going to be it for the, you know, continued poke. Right now, you see Morden, he stood right on top of a ward, and Ferenilord is well aware of that. The Elo King will not fall to such silly pranks.
Such evil-minded games. We do see, though, top lane Morden heading up there. And he does Looked like he's going to be able to get around the backside of Kerb. Kerb is backing off. No vision given here, so he is going to stick and hang around.
So at the moment, he doesn't have any wards. So if Morden does manage to get a good dredge line, they may have enough damage with that ignite of Samix to put down. He's coming in from behind. Double buffs are up. Now, Kerb should still have his Living Shadow and Aranea's nearby. So that immediately is going to send Nautilus away. Pretty much say, nope, I don't really want to get involved with that. Damage, the taunt is too much to deal with.
Yeah, Aranea is sticking around there just a little bit longer because they don't have vision in that river. So they don't know whether Morden has gone back or not. We did also see Kraton has backed off. He's got himself that Vampiric Scepter and a couple of potions. So he's going to be heading back down towards that bottom lane. Ferelinlord, he's getting pursued. You're going to see a flash engage from Extermin. The anchor came through, didn't quite land. We do see the wild cards going through. Will he be able to get it through the hook, though? The stun card will be going down one more time. There's going to be the flash. He is going to get the slowdown on him. Ferelinlord's in trouble here. One more hit should do it. And it's Morden that picks up the kill with the ignite.
So great play out of both Morden and Expert. They burned the flash early, and the dredge line missed at that point.
Red buff, not an ignite.
it was red buff. It's also the W shield from Morden that deal damage over time after he's hit, so there is both of those factors. But in terms of the gank, I almost thought that Frenadol might be able to get away once that dredge line missed, but they carried on chasing, got another gold caught up, and well played by Exa. Now Kreaton's in trouble because here comes Nautilus.
He manages to get caught on. Nautilus is coming back around the side there. Damn. Tasty blood already. He is going to get the slowdown. There's the hail of arrows. Jimbo's picks that one up. Can they get another on towards Jamie? They pulled him in nicely. It's going to be a second. This time it's for Morden. And that is going to be 3-0 already for the Giants. Looking strong in game one.
What a fantastic start to this particular matchup. Two kills on Nautilus plus a kill onto Jimbo's Varus. Not only does Varus have a champion that scales better than Ezreal into the late game, we know that Kreaton likes to build that pokey utility damage comp. So we're falling behind on CS and that kill, it's going to work in their favor.
So as it stands, Ultimate up against it here. Now 2,000 gold behind. Now remember, they did get beaten pretty heavily in game one against the Wizards and came back strong. As it stands, they are in trouble already.
So maybe that's what it needs. Kick him in the teeth and they come back fighting. Right now, though, the Boots of Mobility have been picked up by Nautilus and he's motoring in.
And here comes Morden once again. He's on towards Ferelinlord straight away. The slow goes down. This time they're going to turn it around. Deathmark does go down. Extermin gets dropped very quickly. Can they turn on towards Morden? No, but the damage is done. And it's Kerb that picked up the kill, I believe.
So a good counter kill there from Ultimate, making sure that Kerb roams down. He picks up their kill. He's even on CS. He hasn't even lost any in comparison to his top laner. And they've shut down Exa. Exa does have level 6 and Destiny available, so keep that in mind. One of the things I wanted to mention about that bottom lane kill, Aranea picked up a lot of experience in CS, so he's getting fairly close to level 6 and stands united.
Yeah, you can see the blue buff's going to be given across towards Ferelinlord as well. Expect that to go there. Samux has returned to that top lane. Got himself a Rod of Ages. That would be very quick. That would be very quick indeed. Got himself the Ruby Crystal and the Amplifying Turban along with the armor that he bought at the start. That's against Zed, of course, who had that red pot from the start. He's got himself a Double Doran's Blade, which helped him get that kill.
So in terms of the top lane, it's actually been very boring, to be honest. They've just been farming. They haven't butted heads. We did see an attempted gank from Morden, but neither Rumble or Zed have actually gone aggressive on one another. And if you think about it, Kerb had a pretty difficult time in his matches earlier in the day. He was shut down fairly heavily up there in that top lane by Tesla. And Samux, he's had a bit of a shaky split. He's had some very good games, but for the most part, does tend to just be an add-on in terms of these team fights. He only comes to shining light when he's working with the rest of his team in these 5v5s.
So he's not a diamond.
Not a diamond in the rough, I'm afraid.
No. So Ferelinlord though, both with the blue buff and Extermin. They are going to clear out the waves. Wildcard's getting tossed out there. And now Aranea will be picking that red buff up. So where would he go now that he has this red buff? We do see Nautilus doing exactly the same thing more than in that bottom lane. We'll see if they try and make any roving ganks. We do see it's going to be Extermin going down. It's Jamie they focus on immediately. He's getting no way he's getting out of that one. That's for damn sure. He got completely focused. Two ultis at once.
And Stand United was used on him as well. In the mid lane, Ferelinlord dived onto Morden, but he's going to take a lot of tower damage.
He's going to take a hell of a lot of tower damage. There comes Nautilus. Morden will get out to get one more hit. Should finish him off. And look look at that. Pulled him in beautifully into the tower. And well, even the Elo King makes mistakes.
Yeah, the Elo King falls to the Jester of Nautilus and just gets caught out. Every single ability locked up under the tower. And I think for a little underestimated, Samix is caught.
Samix is caught out there. He's going to put the Equalizer down, but it's not going to be enough. That Deathmark will finish him off. And Kurt picks up another.
What I really like from Samix, though, is he realized he was going to go down. So he stopped and turned around, put as much damage in reply as possible, but didn't burn the Ignite. If he got a couple more ticks off, he may have gone for it. The fact that there's two members of Alternate up in the top lane means that Giants are going to have free reign on this dragon, and this should be uncontested.
They know how to react to these games. They've seen them before, and they're getting straight on that dragon. It's going to be picked up. That will take the gold lead to 3,000 gold here, just 10 minutes into this game. Alternate haven't quite got enough. This creep wave should be enough to take down that top turret, though. That will be the first turret of the game.
So that will balance it out somewhat for Alternate, and you always prefer to get a tower over a dragon. That is something that is a little bit more beneficial. It sticks around for longer, obviously. But the fact that those kills were given up has been a little bit of a problem. The Destiny did try to be countered by Aranea's Stand United, but you see how squishy Sona is. If you focus Sona down, it is actually very easy to kill her. And we've seen that in the previous series, and we're probably going to see it again when they focus down Jayreef.
We see the bottom lane now pushing in there. Bilgewater Cutlass is being picked up across the board, actually. Kerp and Kreator now got those. Of course, we did see Jim Bones is being completed a little while ago. Meanwhile, the mid lane, look at that. Marauder Lord, he's gone straight for Homeguard Boots on the Sorcerer's Shoes early on.
He wants to be back in lane, or he wants to be reacting to this presence. If he decides to recall and, you know, he can maybe catch people out. If he runs to top or bottom lane using that Homeguard and that very quick time to escape the lane, he can catch people out of position. Right now, though, Morden has snuck up into the top lane with those Boots of Mobility. And we'll see whether or not he can catch anybody out. He does not have his ultimate available. He may need to wait for that before he can pick up a kill.
Morden is motoring. I love to see Nautilus with those Boots of Mobility on. He's trotting around.
This particular skin, you can't see his legs quite as clearly, but it still looks really funny.
Yeah, it's the astronaut. And he's bouncing along. That's what you want. But it is going to be for Realm Lord, maybe going to be the next focus target. You see Morden just waiting in the wings off the side there, ready and waiting to go. Stand United not available either, so you're not going to see Aranea coming in to help anyone out right now. Kreator is getting taken a lot of poke, actually, from those plants. The better's well experienced on Zyra in this pro level.
And with the kill and two assists that Babetta has, he has the Philosopher's Stone as well as the Sight Stone already. So all the HP and all the wards is really going to help them just keep and maintain control of that bottom lane. You were touching on Morden moving to mid, and think back to how Morden was camping the middle lane when they were shutting down Alexis from Gambit. It's something that he does very well.
We do see Kurt making a dash down towards his bottom just as the Giants are pushed in here. We're going to see four members as well. Flash Crescendo didn't quite land. Chain of Corruption doesn't go in either. Now we're going to see Kurt. He's going to go straight down towards Jimbo's. He's going to get popped up by the Zoro Ultimate. True Shot Barrage just missing off the side. There's going to be Stand United coming out. There is all five members now of Alternate down in this bottom lane. But now they're going to have to back off. Realmlord didn't quite join them. And this has actually given Samux free reign on the top turret.
I think everybody missed their ultimates there. That, other than Babetta knocking everyone up in the air, Crescendo didn't land, Chain of Corruption didn't land, Trucia Barrage didn't land. The Equalizer's been dropped here by Samix just to maintain control of this top lane and use the minions to the best of their ability. I don't think he's got quite enough damage to take it down, but look at Forellon Lord. He's about to walk past a ward if he goes past the Tribush, and Samix may actually be in trouble.
Samix may be in trouble. Let's see what Forellon Lord's got. He does throw out that Crescent Strike. He actually goes towards the minion, and Samix just says, no, I'm just going to walk around here.
Yeah, the fact that the Crescent Strike missed, you've seen Forellon Lord realizing he didn't quite have the damage Kerp is going to use, but that's a flash.
That's a flash. He gets the stun card down. There's going to be the Nautra also on spin. He will knock him up in the air. Samix already used that Equalizer, but the hook comes in from Morden, and it's Extermin that picks up the kill with all the assists spread across.
Giants are here to win. They are throwing themselves at these kills. I don't think we've seen this level of aggression from their players for a very long time. That was an instant flash over the wall from Exter, and they've caught Forellon Lord.
Dived in once again. Morden is on a mission right now. He's going to get flash away from this one. Is he going to be enough to get away, though? I don't think he will. We're going to see the harpoons coming out. There's the flame spitter. Samix picks up the kill.
So Giants extend that gold lead now to 4,000 gold. And in the bottom lane, Jimbones and Babetta are just beating on Kreator. The tower is now down, and it's not over.
Jayreef taken very low there. Has to back away from this one. Morden actually stealing the blue buff away right now. He could have come across to help those kills. He's actually been spotted by the ward, so he may have to back away from this one.
Take a look at the presence, though. The rest of Giants are reacting. Wow, they hooked him as he went over the wall, but there's the fight.
They're going to go on towards Extermin. Can they turn it around? RNA is now in trouble. He's going to get dropped down. Samax is all over him. Morden picks up yet another kill. Now Jim Bones is on towards Curb. Curb fail flashes, goes into the wall, absolutely plants straight into the forest, and that is going to be another kill picked up by Jim Bones. Giants are on demolition form right now.
There is absolutely nothing stopping in their way. Every play that they make is succeeding, and they are catching Alternate out. In that particular engagement, we talked about how Morden could have gone bottom lane for the kill, but the rest of his team reacted so well and moved up towards him at the blue buff. They got a couple extra, and they stole that blue away.
Well, maybe that experience is paying off. Who knows? They've certainly seemed to have stepped up their level of aggression here, Giants. And remember the chaos that they use on Gambit. This is kind of that style. They love the fast-paced, crazy games.
As long as they are everywhere at the same time, that's exactly what it is. And that's why you tend to see Exterminari either running Teleport, or in this case, he's got Destiny from Twisted Fate. So when something happens, he can respond. He can react quickly. And with Brutal Mobility on Nautilus, he is literally going to be bobbing all over the map at breakneck speed.
He has been sprinting and creating opportunities. 4-0-4 right now. He's been involved all but one of the kills, which frankly I think was a straight 1v1, so that's the only one he missed. You can't blame him too much for that. Jim Bones clears out that wave quite heavily, and look at the CS difference as well between those AD carries. 126 to 93. It's a big difference.
And they, you know, Creighton's been feeling the pressure since the very start of the game. Jim Bones and Babetta have been landing so much poke with that Varus and Zyra combination. We were talking about how the little plants, the vineling, seedling plant towers, were just melting Creighton's HP. And he's forced to use his True Shot Barrage to try and siege a tower, but it's done nothing. It was just a wasted ultimate.
A wasted ultimate. It will be up in a fairly short time, though, but the rest of Giants have reacted. We did see, while that was all happening, Jimbo's down that bottom lane. He just kept on pushing. Now we see, actually, Zamux is getting dived on here. Has to flash away from that one. Throws out that harpoon. He thought about using the stun card on towards Pharrell Lord. Instead, they're going to go for that dragon.
So there was no flash available from X-Down. We've seen him flash gold card on numerous occasions already. They're focusing on dragon, but it's a split decision. Giants are not grouped up as five. They're a little bit spread out. The rest of Alternate are trying to focus down the tower, and they're going to use Equalizer to defend it. So they get the dragon, and they defend. Massive wins for them.
Big, big wing, and now they got five-man push on towards this mid turret. The rest of Alternate, they have to run away from this one because the turret will go down. It's just a couple of shots from Jim Bones, takes it out. Now they're looking for kills, hunting, one might say. 9-2 in kills, and it is 2-1 in turrets. And that gold lead, it is stretching every single time. It's up to 7,000 now.
7,000 gold, and talking about money and items, take a look at Curb's boots. He's picked up Boots of Mobility. On his Zed, this is the first time that we've seen him do this all weekend long. And I'm really happy to see it because it was one of the problems of his Zed play earlier. He wasn't able to react to where he was needed to be at the right time. So we'll see if this works out for them. There's a two-man Giants. They were thinking about going for Curb, but decided to just farm up the wave instead.
Yeah, that's going to be Samux that picks up all of that farming. Sturmin does manage to get the stun card on Pharrell Lord. He's unable to lock him down so far, though. So he's not been picked up really a kill. Not really had a chance to pick up a kill either.
No, not really. He's used his Destiny twice. On the bottom lane, did get that gold card down onto Jayree, which worked out well for him. And the second time was a defensive usage of that ultimate. But nevertheless, it's working into their favor. They've got, you know, map control, they've got the tower advantage, and it's really up to Giants as to when they decide to push and create an engagement.
Yeah, I'm surprised that top turret hasn't been the focus of Giants. They're normally pretty quick to just sweep around and take all of those outer turrets down. It does look like Nautilus this time has managed to sneak himself in there. Looks like they want the kill on Curve, not just the tower. They're quite happy to keep this in the laning phase, it seems, because, well, why not? They're winning out so successfully.
Yeah, you don't want to pick a fight that you run the risk of losing. Diana and Zed have the ability to jump onto targets and kill them very, very quickly. Zyra, Varus, and Twisted Fate are insta-give material for those two targets if they manage to get past Nautilus and Rumble. So that's the reason Giants are running a little bit hesitant and a little bit scared. Those red eyes of Nautilus who's looking for blood right now. It's just a matter of farming your way into it, getting those next, you know, item thresholds, and then deciding to pick your fights.
Yeah, Varus going back down the bottom. Jim Bones is going to get himself up a bunch more farm. Samux doesn't want to get too close to Kerf, it seems. We do have Aranair still coming around his own jungle. And he's going to be picking up anything he can around there to try and play catch up on, really, a race that has effectively been lost already, because Morden with that 4-0-4 now have such a gold advantage over Aranea.
Yeah, Aegis of the Legion is sitting there. It's going to be working towards that Runic Bulwark. Take a look at the positioning. Destiny is available, but the root so well dodged by Kvyat. His reaction time there was fantastic.
Yeah, that was split second. As soon as you saw this, Vines coming towards him. I do not need to be here right now. Probably in some form, he was sat ready and waiting for that one. Didn't have any ward coverage, I tell a lie. There was a ward just around the side, so he may have known that it was coming.
So he may have been aware of it, but nevertheless, a well-timed Arcane Shift gets into safety. In terms of pressure right now, you can see Forenelor dancing around on the blue buff, and there's a number of pings on him. Those are blue pings. There's no actual vision here from Giants other than pretty much guesswork. They made an accurate and informed decision, and it's because blue buff is respawning. So with them grouping up here, this is a four-man Giants. There is Rumble in the top lane. Remember that Stand United from Shen is still available if a fight breaks out.
Yeah, I've managed to clear the ward. There's another one gets placed straight in there. They're going to try and clear it themselves. Vines do land on Forenelord, as does the hook from Morden. Chain of Corruption whiffs, so that doesn't quite catch through. And it is going to be Aranea backing out from that fight. But nevertheless, blue buff was taken. It's Extermin that gets it.
So it's taken away, denied from Forenelord. That's the most important thing. I think Jimbones, if that Chain of Corruption had landed, a bigger fight would have broken out. I imagine the Stranglethorns from Babetta would have gone down, but that was not the case to be, and unfortunately it didn't happen. We do see Kreatin, he's going for the Ezreal build we've seen him do every time we've seen him play in the Summer Promotion Tournament. He's got that Spirit of the Elder Lizard picked up, so going to be working towards most likely Blade of the Rune King, and then something along the lines of that Frostborn Gauntlet, Iceborn Gauntlet.
Stemming meanwhile, he's got that Lich Bane now completed. We do see Forenelord, I don't think Samus has seen him here.
No, not at the moment, but look at Morden. He's just down the lane. Forenelord's going to go in, and here comes Morden.
But look at Morden. He gets straight away the ultimate in there. That's going to be Extermin coming in as well. The stun card completely locked up for Forenelord. Not a chance. He stays at 0-4-1, and it's yet another kill going across, this time to Exterminari.
So I've got to be honest about that play. Forenelord dove straight onto Samix with no information. He knew when nobody else was. Look at the fight.
It's going to be Aranea coming in. Can he get the Shadow Dash on Jimbo's? He's trying his best to sidestep him. He may take down Kreatin before he does. Now he uses the barrier. Has he got enough? He's got a giant creep wave here. He may be able to get on towards Aranea. He's going to have a hail of arrows. He does manage to land it. Has to flash away from them. The piercing arrow was going to be up shortly. And Jimbones in a 2v1 turns it around.
Like a boss strutting his stuff left and right. He dodged the skill shots. He moved out of the way of auto attacks. And his positional play was fantastic. There may be another fight breaking out. No, but Kerp and Jerry aren't going to get there in time. And that's a disadvantage. It was Blade of the Rune King plus BF Sword versus a Bilgewater Cutlass and a Spirit of the Elder Lizard. You are never going to out DPS a Blade plus BF Sword with those two items, and that is the risk of going with that build.
Now with that Infinity Edge complete, Jimbones is going to be going Trollolol next time that fight tries to come out.
Exactly. In terms of DPS, it's a build, and I mentioned this, I think, on Friday or earlier, that if you're ahead, you can stay ahead with it. If you're expecting prolonged fights, you can make it work. But in a straight-up duel, you're never going to win.
Never, ever, ever. Samux, though, he was pushing that top lane while that was all going on, so there's damage already gone towards the top inner turret. And Alternate are almost certainly in a serious situation right now. They could be going 1-0 down. The confidence boost that may give to the Giants, of course, facing off against one of these amateur teams, could be immeasurable.
And of course, we'll see whether or not the loss on the blue on the first game will spur Alternate into action again. Maybe it's pressure that really makes them tick, makes them thrive. I want to go back to that kill from Forenelord in the top lane again. He dove onto Samix with zero information. He had no wards around at the time. He had no idea where people were. And there was a Twisted Fate on the map, and he decided to jump in there. Without being too overly critical, you can't afford to make those decisions or make those plays without the rest of your team to back you up.
Well, Extermin had already gone up towards the top, so they kind of knew where Twisted Fate was. They knew three members were up there, so there was no jungler. The only person that could have been around was support. So it was an educated fight.
Regardless, 1v1 with the TF that's going to jump in and gold card you, it's a questionable decision. And look at the play here from Extermin. Flashes up. Oh, they've caught Jerry.
Jerry gets caught, stunned, and absolutely beaten.
Popped. What was the sound effect? Something like that?
It wasn't the word I was looking at. It's not really a word I can say on air.
So Giants right now, they're grouped up as five. They burn nothing in that engagement other than their normal cooldowns. No ultimates were used. And without that crescendo there, it's going to be a very difficult fight for Alternate to win. Giants have extended that gold lead to 10,000, and they're sieging the in-head players.
You know, it's safe to say Morden's been off the hook so far in this game. He's been throwing them out all the time. There's anchors landing on everyone.
Yeah, in that top lane, he actually baited Verenilord into that fight and managed to pick it up. So we'll see whether or not he actually continues those particular plays right now. 4-0-6, Runic Bulwark completed, Boots of Mobility. And I want to see where he goes next, because if you recall the OGN matches from yesterday, we actually seen a Wit's End on Nautilus.
He had 2.5 attack speed.
2.5 attack speed
Cloud Nautilus. Templar having a little bit of fun. Yeah, so, a little bit of fun now, but it's going to be Exterminator that's getting caught out. Verenilord may well be able to pick up a kill. No, he's flashed away from it. Oh, my word. And for the rest of his team comes in. Morden is unstoppable right now. He's just motoring through.
Oh, it's
Drew Shopperos from downtown Kraton finally picks up another kill for Alternate, and it's on Exterminator. That will be a good kill for them. That will give them a chunk of gold they need.
A very big chunk of gold, and it's gone onto a champion that really, really needs it. Kraton will be using that money to work towards most likely finishing off that Blade of the Ruined King, and then he may actually be able to deal some good damage to the Nautilus and the Rumble, who are fairly tanky. Right now, Babetta's going to get caught by Irenea, but there's no support from the rest of Alternate, so there's no kill potential.
And he actually turns around and thinks, I can take you, I can do this, I've got Morden nearby. And he is being captain.
Morden's
fantastic
everywhere.
Right now. He is everywhere. That's why those boots of mobility are so useful. He has been zipping around the map and landing those hooks every single step.
We'll see how this plays out, because look at Kerp on the bottom lane. He's in the tri-bush. He's waiting to jump on Jim's. There's the clone, and he's jumped.
Is he going to go? Oh, Shade of Corruption missed, and that's going to be Jim Bones going down. There's nothing Morden can do about that one. That was a good kill for Kerp.
Very well played by Kerp. Jim's forgetting maybe that, you know, that dash was going to come in after the ultimate was popped, following after the clone, and unfortunately the chain did miss out. If it had landed, he may have been able to run away with that blade movement speed, but it did not, you know, come to pass, and that killing spree gold, that lands in Kerb's pocket. So, a couple of important moments. Here's Stand United.
They're actually going to go in towards Kraton. Stand United did come out, but he's Exterminator that's straight there, and the immediate stun card on towards Kraton. That's going to take him down. Now they're pushing towards Irenea. He backs off, but this could give Giants the chance to push the top turret.
So the reply to Stand United, the reply to how do you deal with Shen? Have enough damage to kill the target before Shen arrives, or after he arrives? And that's exactly what Giants are doing. Every time we've seen a Stand United out of Irenea, the target, the person that he's tried to jump onto, has been shredded and melted, and his presence has simply had zero impact. Morden is about to find Kerp.
He's about to walk straight in now, and Kerp actually sticking around. He could have backed away there, thought about maybe taking the fight. He could probably take this fight, but the tankiness of Morden's actually scaring them.
Yeah, Morden was actually thinking about chasing there, but Varus was never going to be able to chase quickly enough, so Morden decided to back off, gets that movement speed boost from Boots of Mobility, and bobs his way over to the mid lane.
So the rest of Giants join him in the mid lane. That top wave was pushed. They do have a couple of wards now in towards the top area jungle of Alternate. That may well be the focus of the target they want to go towards. As it stands, though, they are going to push up towards this mid lane, keep the pressure on. 2 minutes before the dragon spawns, so they want to start getting their position made.
And right now, we're starting to hit the point where Giants will be setting themselves up maybe for some tower dives. You've got some very good tankiness, both in the hands of Samus as well as Morden, and you've even got Hourglasses now completed for Exterminare's Twisted Fate. So we may actually see them deciding to go aggressive underneath towers. When you add in the power of, you know, Chain of Corruption, when it eventually hits, as well as the Stranglethorns, it's going to be a very good combination.
Looks like a couple of Baron wards coming out. Oracle on both supports, but Babetta will spot out the wards there. We do see Morn coming back around, and they're going to steal away that red buff. Oh, Babetta might walk straight in towards Verenilord there. Nearly went for it. Crescent Strike did come out, but he didn't land on him.
So take a look at how well Giants are playing in terms of the jungle buffs. They've stolen away two blues, away a red. Right now, though, as soon as Kerb shows himself in the bottom lane, it's going to take a long time for him to get up to Baron. The rest of Giants have started this off. There is vision for them, so they're aware of Ultimate's positioning. And if anyone gets caught up, they may just peel off and try pick a fight with Ultimate.
They've kept the Baron on ticking at the moment. It's down to half health. We're going to see Irenea going in. Doesn't manage to land in. Chain of Corruption goes out. Verenilord is going to get dropped. Equalizer comes across the entire Alternate team. And just like that, they are decimated. Three members going down. There's going to be the ultimate coming out. Destiny will find Jay Ree. You can see the stun card from Extermine. He doesn't want to quite use that. Instead, he's going to be able to lock him up just before he gets in towards the bush. And in comes the Flame Spitter to finish it off for Samux.
4-for-1 plus the Baron. Kerb has not left the bottom lane, but look at Jim Bones. He's come to pick a fight. Deathmark is available. Kerb's gone in.
He's going to go in towards it, but he's managed to get towards the turret. Is it going to be enough? He's going to get popped, and Kerb takes him down. Varus gets dropped, and Jim Bones, well, you're not quite that strong, Sonny Jim.
So 4-for-2 at the end of it, managing to take the Baron as well, and Kerb is not going to be able to do any more damage to the tower, so he's forced to fall back. But what a great play. Not only did they pick up those kills, the way they comboed the knockups, the knockup from Zyra plus Nautilus just prevented Ultimate from doing anything in that Baron pitch.
So inner turret goes down. Now Kerp's going to try and strike on towards Extermin. He's going to have Stan United from Aaron Air to help him out here. So it's going to be a 2v1. Extermin will have the stun card to go down. He's putting it on towards Kerp. He does manage to use that Zonya's Hourglass. He may be able to take Kerp down before he goes. If he can throw out another wild card, pulls out another gold card on towards Aaron Air. The Ignite does take him down. Aaron Air gets stun locked. And now Mordin is chasing. Samux is on him. There's going to be the clutch on towards Aaron Air. The Grasping Root's not quite going to land on towards him. And the dragon attacks the ward as well.
So Aaron Air gets away with his life, but again, we see a Stand United that genuinely has next to no impact. He managed to get in there, managed to land the taunt, and Exter used that Zhonya's Hourglass to perfectly play the situation, had his Ignite available, and to be honest, he never looked at threat of going down.
He didn't look worried. He looked like he had that under full control. Zhonya's Hourglass this time being picked up by Ferelnord. 0-6-3 Ferelnord right now in this game that really counts. Is he going to be able to pick his game up? He has been focused a little bit by Giants, and Morden now 5-1-8, absolutely been phenomenal so far from that jungle. It is Jim Bones, though, that's been focused a number of times by Kerp. Kerp seems to be the only saving grace right now for Alternate.
The question is, when Morden's Nautilus gets banned out in Game 2, will he be able to perform on the same level with a different jungler?
Jarvan.
That we'll have to see. If he can replicate the experiences, if it manages to sneak through, and of course Alternate will have first pick, that's going to be the telling factor, because right now, this game is all about Giants. And look at the wards. 3 for the top laner, 3 for the jungler, 2 for the mid laner, 1 for the AD carry. We talked about this during the, Saturday downtime. If you have money, buy wards, people.
And that is exactly what they're doing. They're going to start peppering out that jungle and pushing in. Blue buff has been pinged out by Alternate, so they want to go straight towards that. But it does also look like Morden is heading that way as he starts to drive through that mid lane. He has got Extermin with him, as is Babetta, and Samux looking like everybody's going to start pushing up that mid lane. We do see Ferelnord backing off. Kerp was trying to split push once again, but this time he can't do it. He has to back away, and you can see all those wards starting to go out now from Giants.
So the thing that's very important about Kerp is he needs to be able to jump onto Jims and then continue dealing damage to both Samux and or Exter. The reason Jims is going to be the primary target is because of how much DPS he's going to put out with the Infinity Edge Blade, Phantom Dancer, and very soon Last Whisper. Exter's going to have Burst, but if you can kill the constant auto attacks from Varus, you can survive that Burst and deal with Twisted Fate afterwards.
Here comes Giants up that mid lane. They've got the Baron on. Morden, of course, did lose it in that exchange, but it was Giants that came out fully on top. Jim Bones, of course, doesn't have it either because Kerp took him down. Morden legs it up towards that top lane. That seems to be the focus target. Kerp is in that bush, ready and waiting to pounce, but didn't fancy too much of it. They haven't really got vision, and now they're going to, looks like, give up this one to Giants.
And remember that the moment that the Giants feel like they're unsure about their opponents positioning, they can just use Destiny. Just use that ability, get full vision of them, and then decide where they want to go. So Baron is still up on a couple of the members, and we'll see how long this lasts. Actually, I think that's just worn off, so see how long they can, how well they can siege up without that ability. But for the time being, this is a four-man stack. There's a 5v4 right now, and it's just a stalemate. It's just a matter of who can land the right abilities first.
They do throw out those Grasping Roots on towards Jay Reed. Took a bit of damage off him. The middle and bottom lane aren't actually pushed up, so Giants really have to brute force this one if they want it.
Well, they have the ability to do so. There's a lot of armor and HP across the board, and the Zhonya's Hourglass to mitigate some of the tower damage. Right now, Varus is pounding away. It's about a third of the HP down, and outside of a flash crescendo from Jayri or a taunt maybe from Aranea, there's not a lot of initiation power other than an all-in. You have to throw yourselves at the Giants, and you can't do that when a team is 13,000 gold ahead of you.
Well, Giants decided that that's not what they're going to go for. They have a, like you say, 13,000 gold lead. It's 6-4 to turrets as well. Giants clearly in control here, and they have been from the very early stages when Morden decided to put his presence felt on the map, and he was just all over the place. Jim Bones getting that lifesteal going, clearing out them golems, clearing out every little bit of resources from Alternate's map. And now the waves are going to push along the top and bottom Aranea passing through a couple of wards there, but it is going to be a bit of a split push coming out from Giants now.
Look at the ward coverage in the rest of the jungle there from Giants. Not only is in that little passageway, they've got pretty much full vision of anywhere where Alternate could be moving in and around their own jungle. It's just going to allow them to really initiate from anywhere. The fact that Morden's got really great range with that depth charge and his mobility, thanks to those boots of mobility, plus Destiny, it's a really good combination, and they've been making it work over and over and over.
So Baron will be up in 1 minute. Looks like Giants are just going to say, fine, we'll clear all of the waves out, keep them all pushed in towards your base, and Alternate, come at us if you think you can take down on the Baron fight. Jim Bones did just get that last whisper completed, so he's got yet more armor penetration now to fend off that Aranea's Runic Bulwark. And he is going to see just how quickly he was melting down that red buff.
Now, take a look at the rest of his items. He's got a 60 CS lead over Creatine. The Infinity Edge, the Last Whisper. In comparison, I mean, he's so far ahead. And there's nothing that Creatine will be able to do in a straight-up duel, in a straight-up 1v1. So if Jims is taken out early, it's a big chunk of Giant's damage gone down. But luckily, Rumble and Twisted Fate both deal equal, if not more, damage themselves.
Yeah, of course. Look, talking about Samux, he's kind of snuck through. He's up to 417. He's got the Zhonya's Hourglass, the Leandria's, the Rylas Crystal Scepter, the Sorcerer's Boots in there, and now building up to yet more damage. He's all about the AP output right now. And honestly, there's not a great deal of magic resist across the board for Alternate either.
No, there's not many defensive items, if any, really. There's a Chain Vest sitting there on Creator and the Runic Bulwark, but that's basically it. Now, Baron has respawned for the second time, and Alternate are again. Kerp is down in the bottom lane. This is going to be a repeat of the previous engagement. Will we see Alternate dive in?
And you can see they're actually ready for this one. We do see Ferelden coming through. True Shot Barrage comes across, but again, Exterminate gets it. Aranea is going to get taken down in the pit. Ferelden flashes out, but look at that straight away. It's going to be Better actually flashing through and picking up the kill. And that is another 2-0 to the Giants, along with the Baron buff. Kerp just split pushing. Not with the team, not really able. I don't understand why they even went in for that when he was split pushing.
So I can understand the decision, but here comes the fight.
They're actually going to get the stun card down on him. Kerp thought about trying to turn this one around, but he just can't do it right now. Exterminate manages to get the damage down on him. He does flash away from this one. While it's happening, Giants, they are pushing through the mid lane.
The longer they can keep Kerp busy, the easier it's going to be to take this inhibitor turret. Jims is melting the HP. That is going to be down shortly, and then they're going to turn over to the inhibitor.
And then they're going to take the inhibitor down, turn up towards that top lane. Remember, they've already taken that top inhibitor turret down to about half health. They can just spin straight round up to their Exterminate. Has got back into position. We do also see Samux. He's split pushing and down in that bottom lane, keeping every objective going. And Giants are just going to go back. Bye.
So Alternate right now, they can't really win a straight up team fight because they're so far behind in terms of items. Kerp is about to find Jim Bones. Deathmark is available, and this might be a dead Jims.
Tries to put the Living Shadow down, but the Hail of Arrows was enough to slow him down. And Jim Bones realized the danger. Instead of just standing there and backing, backed off. Morden picks up the blue buff as well. And this is full control now for the Giants.
Complete control. And the reason that Kerp was down in the bottom lane, he's just trying to split push. He simply cannot win a heads-up matchup. Morden has found Ferelden.
And Samux is there as well. Ferelden goes in. Thought he was being clever, but instead he's just going to get melted. And it's Morden that picks up another 6-1-10.
They didn't need Ignite. They didn't need Equalizer. Only ability they popped there was the Depth Charge, and they simply melted Ferelden. 0-8 right now. Take a look at Kerp. Exter's actually going to 1v1 him.
Exter wants to 1v1 him, pulls out another death card. Oh, and he's going to use that ultimate. He's going to try and dodge out of this one. Instead, he's going to go back around. Will he manage to land the stun card? Uses Zhonya's Hourglass at perfect time on Kerp's ultimate.
So well played by Kerp to at least stay alive. He was forced to burn his ultimate there pretty much to force the Destiny, force the Hourglass, and that is what allowed him to run away. But, oh, he manages to just get away. Kerp is... They Alternate cannot win a team fight. He's trying to split push, but right now Samus is picking a fight.
They're going to try and chase on towards him, uses that equalizer. Finally, the crescendo comes down, but the rest of the base is all getting pushed in, and he still might get away from this one. The ignite on him, finally. It is going to be Kraton that picks up the kills, but look at the rest of the base. They've got super minions coming up the mid lane. They've got Varus and Babetta up that top lane. They're just going to keep on pushing through. Jim Bones is going to be unstoppable soon.
Right now, there is 5 members of Alternate, though. They will be able to jump in here and try to defend. It does look like Ferelden wants to pick a fight, but he's not going to get in range for that Lunar Rush, not going to chase in for the ultimate, and instead, Giants are just going to back away. It cost them one death, but for all the presence that they've got, all the control, and now probably a free dragon, they're going to be happy with that.
While that is true, you could argue that the use of the Baron hasn't been the strongest so far.
Very true, but they have got an inhibitor out of it. So at the end of the day, they don't really need the Baron to maintain control of the map. And with the 20,000 gold lead that they've got right now, they've got enough items to stay ahead. And interestingly, Jimbones is picking up another BF Sword-related item, probably going to be a Bloodthirster, instead of going for something like a Guardian Angel, which would allow him to kill Kerp in the long run.
Well, he's figured they're not going defensive, so why should I?
All in. Why not?
All in. That's what he's going to do. It's 22-8. You can see they have been going all in. Red cards from Exomin will clear out the waves and keep the shove going. The 18,000 gold advantage that they have built up over Alternate, it's looking like they will take it 1-0 here in the first match. Remember, this is a best of five. This is the first of the LCS placement matches. Safe to say that is exactly what it is. It is all about who can get there, who can join Evil Geniuses, SK Gaming, Gambit Gaming, and Fnatic in the LCS Summer Split.
It's going to be a very, very exciting series because we've seen Alternate lose their first game in a fairly similar fashion against the Wizards. And we'll see whether or not they can pull this one back. All right, now it's just a matter of how much time Giants will be able to finally finish this particular game off. That Bloodthirster was picked up by Jimbones, so his damage is just on another scale right now. And you can see extra 579 ability power with 5 items completed.
What about throwing the hook out there, Morden? Instead, we do see the harpoon landing on Jay Reed. Look at that. Just one singular harpoon from Samux. Took a chunk off him. He has got 4-2-10. He has got that Void Staff in there as well, now, along with all of that damage he had earlier on. Piercing Arrow coming out from Jimbones, just wiping out those minions. And now Alternate are facing a bit of a predicament because Giants are starting to split push.
I wouldn't be surprised to see something like a Death Cap coming out of Samux's Rumble as his next item because he's simply so incredibly powerful right now. And the rest of the team is just going all aggressive. So all 5 of them stacked up. That is going to be the tower down. Once that's down, that may signal time to engage. They've caught Jerry.
They've managed to catch on. There's a Chain of Corruption landing straight across. And the Equalizer just melts the rest of the team. You can see Kerp trying to dive in there, but he gets taken down. Ferelanor gets dropped. That is going to be a 3-0 already. There's going to be Extermin going in. Flashes across to avoid damage from the turret. Very well played. He picks up the kill. Can they make it the ace? Aranea flashes away from this one. They're on the Nexus turrets already. And it looks like it's going to be the first game going to the Giants here in this first of a many, many games. It's a best of five, ladies and gentlemen, so don't go anywhere. There are more games to come, but the first one was very much in control by the Giants.
From the game, and let's be very honest, that game was in control by Morden. He was everywhere. He completely set up that early and that mid-game, and I would not be surprised to see a Nautilus being banned out in the next match.
Fantastic performance. Alternate need to reset themselves. Of course, this is going to be a long series. It has to be 3 games, 1 in total, to take them through to the LCS Summer Split.